like LeBron when that one is ring. I think I own a castle, I can see it in my dreams. I gotta pay the mortgage, so I hit a couple schemes. Fish scam, yeah, seafood diet. Heard it's a drought, we gon' muff riot. Young thug dog, yeah, I'm up tired. Mr. President, you move and fire. Can't vote for Donald, cause that don't feel us. Can't vote for Donald, cause that don't kill us. Black lives matter to a need a loan. Credit score good to a want a home. Keep me on that front line, you can keep me in them streets. Yeah, I'm killed the little homie deep on the police. Try to make a star rise, cause they know we gon' loot. I'm ready for the war, that's why I'm lacing up my boots. Yeah.
So if you are not coming to the people's defense, don't challenge us. When young people and other people who are frustrated by the people you hate, you are paying, instigated to be among our people out there, throwing rocks, breaking windows, and burning down buildings. And so young people are responding to that. They are enraged, and there's an easy way to stop it. Arrest the cops. Charge all the cops.
All right. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Heritage Project. I want to thank you all for joining us tonight. My name is Simone Titania Major, and I am an award-winning documentary photographer and filmmaker from Miami, Florida. I have received awards from organizations like the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Oolite Arts, and the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs. It is an honor for me to be a part of the Heritage Committee here at the Adrian Arsht Center for the Performing Arts. It is through this program that we are able to provide a safe space for artists and topics that are often overlooked. We would like to thank our sponsor, Bank of America. Bank of America believes that the arts matter. Arts help economies thrive, help individuals connect with each other and across cultures, and educate and enrich societies. Closed captioning will be available tonight through the link provided in the Zoom chat. We are so happy that you could join us tonight for our fourth episode of the Heritage Project here at the Adrian Arsht Center for the Performing Arts. Tonight, we discuss Black street art and Black Lives Matter as local street artists take us on a journey through their real life experiences. In 1973, hip-hop was cultivated and gave way for a new form of expression. Hip-hop was made of a few special elements, and these include MCing, b-boying, DJing, knowledge of culture, and graffiti. It is my pleasure to introduce our moderator for tonight, Alan Kett. Alan Kett is a world-renowned graffiti artist, writer, lecturer, graffiti historian, producer, publisher, and painter. He is the co-founder of the Museum of Graffiti and is breaking ground as the only museum in the world that exclusively shines light on graffiti art history and is located right here in Miami in the heart of Wynwood. Kett will guide our esteemed panelists in this informative conversation about the connection between the Black Lives Matter movement and the expression of Black street art. We will have a Q&A tonight, so please feel free to leave your questions during this discussion. If you are committed to lifting Black voices up in our community, please consider donating to the Miami Diaspora Fund. Thank you all for joining us, and without further ado, Alan Kett. Thank you.
Simone, and welcome everybody. It's a pleasure to be here and moderate this conversation today about Black street art and Black Lives Matter. And I'd like to start off by introducing our esteemed panelists. We have a wide, diverse crowd tonight, a group tonight. So I'm gonna start off with Ashley Thomas. With a With a professional career in theater and dance and a stellar academic focus in marketing and public administration, Ashley Thomas has seamlessly integrated her creative passion and professional career. She is an award-winning grant writer and co-founder of Muse, an arts production company that brings brands and ideas to life with art. She serves as the president, creating economic opportunities for artists from heritage neighborhoods through Muse pop-up galleries, festivals, and heritage programming. But she's also an artist herself. After graduating from Florida State University, she took a six-year sojourn to Los Angeles, where she studied dance professionally with the Los Angeles-based company Contra Tiempo Activist Dance Theater. Independently, she has created full-length choreographic works, workshopped at Disney Concert Hall, and premiered at the prestigious Highway Theater in California, and so much more. But we'll let her talk to us about her career tonight and the work that she's doing in the community that's very important here in Miami. Next, we have Ariel Vergas, AKA Black Brain. And Black Brain is a pop noir artist disrupting beauty and thought. His gifted art psyche develops stories that bring color to the mundane, dialogue to the mute, and personality to the dull. These are his words, but I'd have to say I agree with him. His work is a voice for the transitional generation. Black Brain's apprenticeship commenced at the Design and Architecture Senior High in Miami, Florida, and matured at the Cleveland Institute of Art. His in-demand talents have globally guided him to award-winning design firms, including Hasbro, Takara 11, and Carton Design, where he was recognized with a CES Innovation Award, an IDA Residential Sustainable Design Award, and named the 2009 IDA Product Designer of the Year. And his work is seen in the streets of Miami here in Wynwood. So welcome, Black Brain, as well. Next, we have Shire Regans. Shire Regans, aka Vanta Black, was born in St. Louis, Missouri, and lived there until her family relocated to Miami in the late 1980s. Crime was out of control in St. Louis, and Miami was viewed as a refuge of sorts by her mother. Her passion for art began soon after. After graduating from Florida A&M University, Shire began to focus primarily on drawing from life and portraiture. As societal issues began to weigh heavily on her conscience, a message took shape behind the imagery. The emergence of the Black Lives Matter movement pushed Shire's art in the direction of social awareness and change. Shire also serves on the Community Relations Board's Criminal Justice and Law Enforcement Committee, and formerly a teaching artist at the Perez Art Museum in Miami. Shire is a proud mother, visual artist, truth teller, and community advocate. Shire is also the Fall 2020 Artist in Residence with the Community Justice Project and a resident artist at the Bakehouse Art Complex. Welcome. And we also have Rosa Nade Garmendia. As a socially engaged multidisciplinary artist, Rosa produces work at the nexus of contemporary art and activism. Her work is rooted in social issues triggered by an interest in the human condition and her experience as a multi-ethnic Cuban woman, immigrant, and industrial worker. Her personal relationship to colonization, experience of otherness, resilience, and conflict have made it possible for her to identify with cross-cultural social issues, and her artistic process is a tool used to reflect on social and philosophical issues, highlighting and creating a safe space for the viewer to be provoked, explore, interpret, and find purpose and meaning in the issues we are facing. She considers her artistic practice a daily act of resistance. Welcome. So folks, let's get into this discussion and talk about art in the streets and art in your lives. And so this question is really open to whoever would like to jump in and answer. And so when did you first realize that art had impact on those around you, not on yourself, but on your community or on members of your community?
Ashley's going to jump in there. Thank you so much, Kat, for those great, you know, introductions. I also want to introduce my business partner, Bart Merville. He's a co-founder of Muse. He was listening in on our talk before, and he'd be a great asset to this conversation. So I'm happy to have him here. Hello. And so art to the people and influence. I mean, as early as the age of 9, so I got a chance to attend the African Heritage Cultural Arts Center right here in Liberty City, heart of Liberty City. And I watched myself and my class, my cohort, literally evolve from that space into visual artists who go on to magnet programs, who are now working on Broadway, who like economic viability was promised to them because of this program. So I learned on an early age, like now looking back, that art was important. And when I look at my colleagues, they're out in the world doing amazing things. And we all started right at this cultural hub and this cultural center. So it was put into our bodies at a very young age. And I could feel how important it was then, but I definitely, seeing the result of it, can vouch for it even more right now.
Thank you. Anybody else want to add in and to how or when they realized that art had an impact?
Alan, I would love to jump in on that. What was really interesting for me was that Black Brain originally came from the idea of like having your mind blown. And that looks like a charred brain. So it was a black brain. But one of the like properties that I kind of like played around with and developed was this form called Malcolm X-Men. And I didn't realize just how much these pop culture icons really meant to people. And when people would see their work, they would say, wow, this is the first time that I see my face in all of the heroes, you know, that I grew up with. And Black Brain, for most people, seems more like a racial connection, which wasn't the original intention, but it fits and it actually like fed into the story of like representation of the Black community and pop culture.
I can jump in. Good evening, everyone. I've been an artist ever since I can remember. But it wasn't until I was in art school that I actually went to a museum or a gallery. And it wasn't until I started working as a teaching artist in a museum, in an art museum, that I was able to see the impact that art can have on people. So it wasn't with my own personal practice, but with the work of other artists.
That's very interesting. Shire, would you like to say anything or we'll jump into the next question?
Yeah, I think that when I first learned to express myself, it was visually. And before I was comfortable speaking, I was making marks. So I knew that these marks that I would make and what inspired me to make these marks was important. And as I became exposed to art more, I saw that this was something that was really, really important to me. And I knew that it was something that I would want to pursue. And I think it became more important when people started to discourage me from pursuing it. And I always felt like this is what I was supposed to do, express myself visually. And once I learned to express myself vocally, verbally, it was a wrap from there. And I think that, you know, art has a way of touching people broadly. And we've seen it over the past few decades, what art can do in a broad spectrum. And I'm really thankful that so many different types of artists have really started to engage in social issues.
So I love hearing these different stories, and I'm really curious as to learn, you know, who were those initial influences or what were those triggers in your lives that got you to consider this road, this, whether it's an artist or an organizer in the arts, you know, what were those early influences, if you remember?
So I had an art teacher when I was in elementary school. Her name was Ms. Pinkham. And she saw something in me, and she gave me all the things, all the materials, all the things, because she knew that this was something that I wanted to do. And she guided me on to, you know, going into a magnet program, and then, you know, the magnet program that I was in, at South Miami Middle, I had a teacher there who saw something in me and decided to push me even further, Mr. Summers. And then it went on from there. So it's probably one of the reasons why I became an educator, because I understand the importance of an educator in a young person's life. And I'm really thankful that I had educators that knew the type of push that I needed as a young Black girl, you know?
And anybody else, please, this is open to the panel.
I'm gonna jump in there. I wanna first give a shout out to the 1619 shout outs over there. Okay, so Kat, yep, Shire, I love it. We need one right here. All right, paying homage to the ancestors. And I'm paying homage to all the local Miami, and I'm gonna say all the local Miami teachers that touched my life. So Shire, you hit on it, education. Marshall Davis, you know, who's right now the director of, I'm bringing it back up, the African Heritage Culture Arts Center. I know a lot of cities don't have such a gem, and we were very, very lucky to have a center that was centered in Blackness, in art. Shannon Haynes, Super Black Girl, AKA Tracy Young. We have people who came out of there, Bayunga Kialuka, who was a visual artist there, Mr. Blackman, Melton Mustafa. Like, I got a chance to train under so many big names. Marshall Davis, who's on Broadway as Tap. And I know this is focused on Black street art and Black Lives Matter, but all of that, to me, that freedom of art and joy and history, like, kind of wound up is what I learned from those teachers there. And they let me see that this was possible. They would leave Miami every year and go off and perform wherever they were and come back and just bring us so many gems, so many nuggets, so that we felt empowered to go out and do it ourselves. So I'm giving homage to 62nd and 22nd Avenue.
Great.
Nice. For me, it was actually a lot of my peers and family. I'm lucky that I grew up in a household that my art and my talents were always encouraged. And I actually went through and got like classical and scholastic training since middle school, really, like through different magnet programs and other things. And Miami is unique in that way. It's more common now, but back in the 90s and early 2000s is one of the few places that actually has a plethora of different art programs for the youth. And through the art schools, I actually had a lot of like really amazing, like older mentors or older, like relative, you know, cause I was still a kid, that, you know, were in the graffiti and, kind of circle. So I have a lot of peers that were better than me that I looked up to, and, you know, they showed how, you know, you can use it as a voice, you can use it as a tool, but you can also use it as therapy and healing, you know? And it's the balance of like when to use it to be vocal and when to use it to like stabilize your inner self, you know?
For me, you know, art has always been a way to cope with society, really. When I was in school, I was a terrible student. I never went to any classes, but because I could draw and paint, I was able to get C's and D's and pass. I remember I went to South Miami Senior High School, and my art teacher there, Jim Hunter, was very supportive. And he introduced me, like Shire, he introduced me to a lot of, to drawing, to materials. I was able to not go to class, you know, like math class, and stay in the art class. So he encouraged me to go to school. But my immediate family are immigrants, and they're very much into small business, and they had a small business. So they didn't really want me to be an artist, because you don't make any money as an artist. So they wanted me to do something else or to find a way to use art to support myself. And that was a really big struggle for me. And I went to art school, my master's, I dropped out of that, and worked in industrial jobs around the country, in Detroit and New York. So it's not a straight road for me. And I always use it as a way to cope with things that I am anxious about.
Thank you for that. Thank you for sharing that. And, you know, when we start to talk about our careers and influences in our lives to get us to where we are today, parallel to that, there's things that are going on in the streets. And whether it's, you know, in our hometown or just everywhere, there's movements. And one of the movements that exists here in Miami and has existed for a very long time is the graffiti movement, and recently in the past 10 to 20 years, a street art movement. When was the first time that you considered or engaged in anything having to do with street art, or said, okay, maybe it's not just the academic art world, or maybe it's not just theater, or there's something in the streets that's maybe off the beaten path for me, but that I would like to explore or engage with, if anybody could share.
I can start that off. You know, I think this is a really valuable conversation for artists and for other folks. For me, graffiti art, street art, murals are all a form of creative expression. And there's a lot of power to be transformational for the individuals who make the art, but also for the communities where the art exists. And I did some, you know, the great thing about street art and graffiti art and murals is that it's public, it's open. People don't have to pay to see it. It's in their neighborhood, or it's, you can drive to the park, or, you know, it's in a school. So, and you know, it's one of the oldest form of art. I didn't know about the graffiti museum. So I went the last week to check it out. And I was very happy to see that you've documented the history of graffiti art. Because, you know, it's like you say in the museum, graffiti, you know, from the Italian word mark making painting. I mean, humanity has been doing that ever since humanity's on earth. So for me, they're very important forms of art, and they have a lot of similarities. And I've done some murals myself, but it's hard to get a wall, right?
Yeah, for me, like if I could continue off of like where she ended, I don't see graffiti art and street art as a new movement, but I see it as a circling back to the original movement, which was getting your message on a wall. Back in the day, was it was a cave painting. You know, the Egyptians did it through reliefs and murals. The Renaissance has it as I forget the term or not, the with you know like their paintings that on the wall. And one of the big inspirations was the Sistine Chapel, and seeing what Michelangelo did to transform that area, and just seeing like it took him like 13 years or something ridiculous. My numbers might be off, you know, at me. So for me, it was really like a going back to, you know, one of the original forms of public art, or even just communicating your idea. And, you know, I lived in LA for 12 years, and just seeing the amount of work before it was popularized by, you know, Exit Through the Gift Shop and other more pop cultural things in the last 20 years, you know, I got to experience a lot of the raw, you know, street art. And then in Miami growing up, there was always graffiti. So you got to see it. And I had a lot of family in New York. So yeah, I think it's like almost like a cathartic resurgence of like the original form of us creating.
Hey, I love it. I'm gonna hop in there. Bart, influence, street art. When did you first recognize it?
Well, for me, it was growing up. I would see how our culture would memorialize our heroes on the walls of our grocery stores and or the corner bodegas. So those were some of the first impressions that I've had when it came down to street arts and graffiti as well. And especially like the neighborhoods that I grew up in, like up north, it was also gang territory as well. So it was also used to signify turf as well. So
and just adding on to that, for me, like when you talk about street art, as a kid, I didn't recognize that the MLK restaurant was street art, you know, what they put up there, as he's saying, like MLK, I didn't recognize it or define it as that. It was a sign, you know, because we we didn't afford signs or those signages that need permits and stuff like that. So very much, I grew up in Liberty City. I grew up in Brownsville. And so every sign, every store, it was painted. It was used, a street artist was there putting their hands on the signage and putting the fish signs and the beer signs and the liquor signs, you know, for the supermarkets. And then very much like Black Brain has said as well, and Kat, we talked about this, defining what street art is to all of us, the tagging that comes along, you know, with the street art, or that Wild Wild West that comes with it, that's been, you know, all my life. Paying attention to it as like a worldwide phenomenon is really, for me, I moved back here in 2014, and Wynwood was already hustling, bustling. Art Basel had already, you know, made its way here. And Wynwood, I had never experienced, I had never seen anything like that. And the walls were just out of this world. And I was so impressed by what was happening and transforming in the city. So that's the first time I go, ooh, this is street art, you know, for me.
Two experiences that stick out in my mind, right? I remember being young and walking to school and taking in everything that I would see around me because it was part of our exercises in art. But I remember marks being made in the concrete and being there forever. And I remember, you know, I used to, you know, pay attention to those things and wonder about who made those marks and whose name that was, right? I don't know if that's classified as street art, but it is literally art within the street. Then I remember when I was in the art magnet at South Miami, part of our curriculum was lettering. And I remember certain students, their lettering would look like graffiti art. And I remember being so fascinated by it and just the vibrancy and then the line quality. And I also remember students who gravitated towards that type of art being discouraged from doing that type of art. And, you know, fast forward to today. But those memories really, really stick out in my mind.
It's really fascinating to me to hear all these different perspectives on what is street art or what you remember seeing growing up or in your neighborhoods, whether it's the sidewalk writing or the store signage or the murals to, you know, as Bar was saying, you know, about heroes or maybe someone that's passed in our community. There's so much diversity in what we see in the streets as what I like to call public art. So it's sort of art in the public space. To me, as someone that really studies this, street art typically or graffiti is something that is unsanctioned or something that's done illegally without anyone's permission. So we don't ask for permission. We just go paint when we want to paint and we write what we want to write. And so it's a bit outside of the law and it's outside of sort of, you know, that organized, how do I get a wall, Rosa, kind right. of situation that you were mentioning. Like, who do I ask? Who do I talk to? And for us now as adults, like, you know, Shire with her mural on the bakehouse, it's very easy when you're an adult to go and figure out how to get a wall and to get a meeting and to get a conversation going with people. But when you're a teenager and you knock on a business and you say, hey, can I paint your wall? You're quickly dismissed. And so that's why kids typically go out and paint at night. It's because it's easier to ask for forgiveness than it is to ask for permission, you know, and now it's an old tradition. And so this is a tradition. When we started off the conversation, we talked about hip hop culture and we talked about, or there was a mention of hip hop culture and its history. This is a 50-year-old movement in the street. And so we're a part of it. And, you know, and hearing Ashley speak about Wynwood and the emergence of it in Wynwood, how she saw it in 2014, you see a lot of murals. Miami has been transformed, much of it. And it's not just Wynwood, it has spread out to this graffiti, street art, mural art destination like never before. And so I wanted to ask you a little bit about your impressions as to
You know, and I think, you know, Shire, you hit it on the head as to the impression that you see people have with street art or public art or sidewalk art or teenage art versus more of this Eurocentric frame of mind of, you know, high art or highbrow art or museum or gallery art. You know, I'm not sure that you all in your personal work are affected by it, but as people that are within this community, you might encounter other artists or friends or peers or you know, that are working. Do you see that difference or maybe stereotyping or conflict in your lives? Open to anybody to comment or not.
Yeah, for me, it's been really interesting because I grew up with there not being a difference, you know, where like everything was more guerrilla style. And then, you know, as I became a business owner and everything else, understanding the other side of the ladder. And, you know, one of the things that's the most interesting for me is really the dialogue with the streets, you know, so like a lot of the, nowadays when I paint a mural or I do a piece, I expect that the streets are going to talk back. And if you did a great job, like representing yourself and representing the community while you were there and being a positive energy for people, you know, when you come back or when you're in the street, you know, like, you know, people will give you an update, you know, on what's happened to the mural and, you know, that whether it was a knucklehead or whether it was like legitimate, whatever. And you actually build rapport with people. Like I had one piece that, you know, got tagged up, you know, they're like, oh man, we love the piece. It was just some knucklehead. So I came back and retouched it. And then it got tagged up again, but this time it was like referencing a Psalms quote. And I was like, yeah, that's dope. You know, like if it's positive, awesome. And if they want you there, awesome. You know, like a lot of times, you know, that's a red flag of like, hey, we don't want you there. We didn't appreciate your energy. We don't appreciate what you're doing. And, you know, the streets talk back and it's up to you to either learn how to harmonize with the community that you're going into or get out, I think.
I'm going to go like the five elements of hip hop and give a little bit of historical context and then where I see that movement right now. We think about, you know, graffiti, DJing, MCing, b-boying, all of those great things that came out of the hoods. It was a way to communicate, have conversation with each other, and also tell the institution, you know, how we were feeling at the space when you did not have news, you did not have media, nothing was in your favor. And so when I think about how the graffiti movement started, it was really to stick it to the institution and to fight the power. Where it is now, it seems very trendy. And so I mentioned this before. It's like when you talk about, and I'm going by the definition of unsanctioned art, you get to do it on your own. There are very few pieces that I see unsanctioned that are politically relevant, that are having conversation. You know, Ariel, great that you had the Psalms quote, but most of what I'm seeing in the streets is more of a piss contest, a tagging. There's no art around it. There's no conversation. There's bombing around it. So for me, the movement itself as like how it started, like movements do, it's 50 years old, right? The timeline of a business is 30. So it's transformed, it's morphed, it's, you know, commodified, appropriated, all of those different things into something different. And it definitely has lost to, for myself, the relevance of what unsanctioned, if I say protest art, because that's to me what graffiti was. And is now, it's very, very different.
Very interesting answer. And I love it. And, you know, and I agree with you to a degree, but I also believe that it's an art movement started by children and teenagers and kids. And so a lot of times what they were, you know, these young artists were trying to do is really just express themselves and have fun and have a good time. And maybe be a little bit mischievous, you know? And I think that, you know, many times romanticize sort of the reasons for the creation of some of these things, but a lot of it was just for fun, you know? And so when I think about what I see on the streets now, although we might not appreciate all the tags, a lot of those kids are out there, you know, or young adults are doing it for fun. But I want to switch gears a little bit to something that you were saying, and you were calling out protest art, and how maybe some of the graffiti of the street art that you see now either is more tagging, it's more egocentric, or maybe it's more decorative is what I see. It's really about, you know, beautiful flowers or something that doesn't necessarily have a political voice. But we've seen recently, I've been paying attention to this shift, and I would attribute it to the Black Lives Matter movement and the murder of George Floyd in what started to happen in the streets. Does anybody care to comment on just for themselves personally, how they felt when George Floyd was murdered, and then what the reaction that they saw in the streets, if at all you started to notice that?
Yeah, for me it was huge, because like when I moved back from LA, I had done like this this political series, like Why So Serious, where I had like the Joker and Bat and Trump views. And when you're doing political driven art, you know, if you're not careful, it can go really dark. And so I kind of like put it on pause for a while. And when George Floyd was murdered, it really woke up that inner voice. I said, hey, you know, you need to speak on this. And I was going into like this really cynical place with the art. And it was actually through the museum, Alan, that you guys reached out about helping out with the American history mural that we did. And it was for me, is just realizing like how many people were moved by like what they were seeing on their phones, and how, you know, calling out the injustice is one step, but also like showing the history and showing the progress is actually the better healing step, you know. So it is important to like vocalize the protest. It's also important to recognize the positive, because when you start with the positivity, you know, you're more likely to continue a conversation versus getting stonewalled, you know. My experience anyways. So like I felt like this time going into the political art through this historical lens and through this progress lens was extremely healing, and able to like just go represent it with a lot of dignity, you know, versus like trying to one up and be clever and like, you know, really aggressive with the imagery, even though there were some very aggressive images, you know.
So Black movement to art and healing. When George Floyd died, you know, I'm overwhelmed with emotion right now. If anybody, which we know the world saw the video because the world stood up and like literally said how it felt. I'm like the politically correct answer is I was hurt, and I know we're in an institutional conversation, so I'm gonna leave it at I was really hurt. But I gotta tell you, you know, I said, you know what, I got a Second Amendment right too, and if the law cannot not kill people, then I need to defend and protect myself. I need to be like Malcolm, and I need to make sure that in my community, I need to be like the Panther. I need to, like, I was buying books online to figure out how the Black Panther start their movement, to like start it again and rally people up and say, you know what? We're gonna protect our own streets. I heard defund the police. At that moment, I was like, let's go. You know, let's go ahead and just get away from the whole system. Art was the furthest thing from my mind. I gotta tell you, I was really, really angry, and I'm still very hurt. Extremely hurt, by watching, you know, what I saw. I'm sorry, I'm very emotional right now. Because it's just one of those things you just don't want to see a man die like that. And we all had to watch that in the middle of a pandemic, in the middle of a really, really hard time for everybody. And so when those young people went out, you know, I was like, I got bail money and I'm ready to support. That is how I felt at that very moment. So,
you know, for me, when George Floyd was murdered, realistically, I was like, you know, how many more times are we going to have to see Black death? Because, you know, we had seen it so many times before. And I think the difference, when this brother was murdered, the difference was that we're in the midst of a global pandemic, and people are forced to pay attention to what's happening. So there were participants in this dialogue that hadn't participated before. Black folks, we've been talking about this for decades, but now other people are participating in this dialogue because they watched that video. And they didn't ignore this video like all the videos before. I haven't seen the video, but you know, I try to protect my spirit. So I think that the people that watched it, they needed to see it because they had been ignoring us for decades. And one of the good things, there are many good things that came out of uprisings. The fact that there were global uprisings, the fact that people were participating in these uprisings that didn't give a shit before. And I also like, you know, what artists had done across the globe. We saw murals of George Floyd everywhere, Haiti, Europe, all over the US. And I think that, you know, it was a moment, that one right there, you know? And that's one of many murals that popped up across the country. And I think that if it takes a pandemic for people to stop and pay attention to Black death, then, you know, so be it. I'm glad y'all paying attention now.
You know, the first anti-police brutality demonstration I went to was actually in the Twin Cities in Minneapolis in the early 90s. And I remember where I was when Rodney King was beaten to death. For me, I actually started to do work around police, documenting, you know, the names and dates of men, women, and youth killed by police in the United States with Michael Brown's death or his killing. That for me, I'm a bit older, I think, than most of you. So his murder was for me a game changer as far as my personal practice. At that point, I decided I'm not gonna be painting little stuff. I'm not gonna try to sell art anymore. I'm gonna do what I think I should do with my work. So for me, social justice work and my art practice really started with Michael Brown's death, actually.
And I want to add on to that. It was like, it wasn't just George Floyd. You know, I know we're going to change it. It was like Ahmaud Arbery and then Breonna Taylor and then George Floyd. So it was like, it was a powder keg, you know? So that's really what it felt like. So those overwhelmed emotions was just like having these deaths, Philando, they happen all the time, but those are the three just like, you go like, what is going on here? You know? And just, you know, everybody had to take it to the streets.
Yeah, for me, to jump in with what Rosa was saying, it was the John Brown, but also like with that we had the trifecta because it was
right.
Trayvon Brown and White, and for me that's when like Malcolm X men transitioned from like just a cute meme to like actually using covers to like represent what was going on with in politics and in, you know, like these young Black men's lives. I think the coming seeing it again with the trilogy, if you will, this time around was just like, really again? You know, it hasn't even been 10 years.
I know. Inside. Yeah.
Can, you know, you were mentioning Black Brain, just it hasn't been 10 years, we're here now. You know, one of the works that you were a part of is this American History mural that I had up on the screen that's been behind your screen during this talk. That was an answer for us here in Wynwood to all these killings and to how to participate and have our voices heard. Can you tell us a little bit or just walk us through, you know, the art that you created there, you know, with your collaborators?
Yeah, for sure. So this piece was, it was really cool because it was like, eight different artists and we had to communicate a lot of story in a finite amount of, you know, real estate. And the vehicle used was using, you know, the portraits and events within the letters, which just made a really tense, it made like each letter a snapshot into like really intense, you know, pivotal moments in our current history, you know. It's like, because when we were doing the discussion, the brainstorming, it was like, how far do you go back, you know? So we went back, what, like 1900s, early or late 1800s? And in doing this piece, it was like, it was so fun and easy to do, you know, like the Muhammad Ali's and, you know, the Martin Luther King and some of these figures that we all know. Because it became a challenge of making sure that you represent them well so that they're easily recognized. For me, some of the harder ones were like the M and the E, where we're looking at the Rosewood Massacre and the Tulsa and Rosewood Massacre and, you know, the KKK, you know, like assembling peacefully in front of the White House, you know? And, yeah, those were really intense. It was like, how can we communicate this dark part of our history? And I think the yellow really helped make it not so dark, you know, because it's really easier to go negative with it. But I think that it was sandwiched by heroes, just made it so much more palatable. You know, I can't imagine if I did that KKK mirror, the Rodney King things, without it being sandwiched by some positivity, you know?
The idea behind this, I think, was to be proactive and showing that this wasn't just a moment in time today, that this has been going on for so long, but to also to push for liberation. Can you, any of you speak on that and on art as a tool for liberation and positivity and how do we continue to create and not just be reactionary?
You know, I want to talk a little bit about that because I think that that exposing or talking about history, showing we're visual people, showing what's happened before. Because I do agree that for me, the importance in this contemporary times is that more artists and art inside galleries and in the public sphere have become more political because of what's happened. And I'm glad history was talked about because, you know, if you look, you know, Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Rodney King, Arthur Lee McDuffie, then you think about Los Angeles, 1992, right? Detroit, 1967, Harlem, Chicago. So we all know that this is not new. So history, I think, is important. I know that, you know, I do a lot of research on police violence. That's sort of what I've been focusing on. And, you know, and the work that I do, I want people to think about and talk about what is the root of police brutality and injustice? Why does police killing spark unrest, and not just today, not yesterday, but for decades, right? Why is it that to end, what's going to take to end police injustice? That's something I'm very, you know, this whole conversation, I agree with Shire, whoever said that today the conversations are broader. There are more layers of society talking about this. There are people, there are scholars writing, there are shows on the radio and on TV. And there's a real broader conversation, I think, about what is it going to take. And some of the things that I write, that I've been thinking about because of reading I've done, is some of the writing is talking about systematic racism and how it goes hand in hand with policing Black and Brown communities. But you know, it's a, I think we're not at the beginning of this conversation because it's been happening for decades, but I do think it's broader and artists have an important role to take, to play if we take up that challenge, I think. Sorry, I went on too much.
Well, let me say this. I surely don't think it's the artist because that has anything to take, because the artist has been doing it for years. But the point is, we've been silenced. And so unless you're saying that you're gonna challenge Time Magazine, you know, the New York Times, you know, the Miami Herald and all those institutions to change their way of thinking, then we're gonna have this conversation on repeat all the time. So yeah, when you say it's institutional, it starts with the educational system. It starts with the court system. The police are last on the totem pole. They're the very last because they've been given power by these particular institutions. So when we say the artists have been trying for eons to get their message out. I mean, hell, you know, the fist has been there for how many years, right? But it's always been shut out. So,
yeah, I want to add to that. So to the answer, I think Mobizi, you asked a good, how do we stop it from being reactionary? And Rosa, like adding to your point is creating space. And so ownership of space is very important. And I think we like ownership of media, ownership of narrative, us owning those spaces, and technology has given us the opportunity to do that in a way it hasn't been done before. Muse, we exist because there was a lack of representation during Art Basel, during, you know, Miami Art Week, in those spaces of Black centered art, of African diasporic art. There's a few people now, a few producers in that collective growing the movement, but it was a response to, you know what? We have space. We are in Little Haiti. We are in Liberty City. We are in Overtown. We're in Alapata. Maybe it won't make it to the Herald, but we know right here that these conversations are happening. There are subcultures who, minorities in this, and I'm just gonna say it like that, who protect themselves. They get legislation passed to protect themselves. Mm-hmm. They make sure that their children don't go into the juvenile justice system. They have programs that divert their community to a community trust or a community, you know, rehabilitation program, so their children don't get records. And so we say to ourselves, nobody's coming to save us. The system is set up. It's a 1,000-year-old system, just about, and it's on autopilot. White people aren't trying to be evil. You know, institution isn't trying to be evil at this point. It's just on autopilot. So how do you work in a system that's on autocorrect? So how do we work on a system? People can't be afraid to say the word Black. You got to say it and you got to be okay with it. You can't be afraid of it. And I feel like the only way that I can make people feel comfortable, and you go like, you know, someone told me, don't be so confrontational. Well, art allows me not to confront you, to repel you, but to bring you in. So when you come into the Muse campus, you'll see beautiful art. We did a show called Disperse, you know, so you can see a mural, you know, by Oliga here, who's a street artist and muralist. He's around Little Haiti. You might not know him now, but he's on his way up. You're going to know him, you know, unsanctioned or sanctioned art.
That's because we're allowing him space.
But we're providing him space to be himself, to express himself. Shire, I said on another call that we were all together, those tags, they do pass us. I'm not going to pretend they don't tag our building. So I know that the streets know also who and not to bother. You know, they know if a local person is there or if a person who owns the building doesn't even exist in their community. They know it. And so they go for it. So it's us coming into our own communities, coming back into our communities and saying, hey, I want to blank canvases. I want to be the artist of this space, you know, not waiting for it to be gentrified and then saying, hey, I used to live here, you know, please hear me out. We have to own space. and it'll stop being reactionary because we protected ourselves. So, law.
You know.
And if I, oh, okay.
Yeah, you gotta wait, brain. you know.
I love to wait.
And my response to this dialogue is that my role as an artist is to tell the truth. It's to tell the truth in every space that I exist in, right? But I also want to occupy spaces that are not just Black spaces, right? That are not just traditionally Black spaces. I want to go in everybody's space and tell the, ooh, almost cursed, to tell the truth, right? And Ashley brought up the Miami Herald, and I love that she brought up the Herald because the Herald, I was in a dialogue with the Herald yesterday because they want to really shift how they portray Blackness in their publication, right? So they invited a group of community leaders to meet with the editors to talk about, okay, how can we not play stereotypes upon you? How can we tell stories accurately and with care, right? So I appreciated being in that space because I knew it was my job to tell the truth, and they got the truth in that space. And what I also appreciate is that they're going to make a point to respond to the feedback that they got in that space. So I think it's important to exist in Black spaces as a Black woman, right? But I also want to be in they space as a Black woman, because you're going to get this truth from this Black woman, this Black artist, and this mama, because that's all I know how to do is tell the truth. And I really, a lot of feedback that I've gotten about the body of work that I've worked on for nearly 5 years is that these stories are tragic. Don't you want to tell happy stories? Don't you want to focus on something else? No, this is the truth. As long as Black people are dying, I'm going to talk about that. And I think that those critiques or those responses come because this type of work makes people uncomfortable. Be uncomfortable. You should not be comfortable with Black death. So, you know, I really take my, not to say nobody else does it, but I really take my craft very seriously. And my goal is to occupy spaces and tell the truth in those spaces.
That's good. What I wanted to add was that, especially everybody here, is that we're all leaders in one form or another. And to kind of jump in on a bit of dialogue that was happening earlier, you know, in regard to, you know, just bombers or, you know, like young people with just writing their names on the walls, et cetera. I think one of our responsibilities is to get all that raw energy. It's like, hey, you're willing to spend your own paint, you know, hit up a wall where nobody's looking, you know, do whatever. You know, whether it's just a cathartic place to rebel against, like, just being another statistic, and you're saying, I am here, you know, that's whatever that your current motivation is. As leaders, we can inspire them by activating them towards a focus, you know. And I think Muse does a great job, the museum does a great job, but, you know, like, I think as we can be more proactive and giving, we call them, like, in design, for like design prompts, you know, it's like parameters. It's like, yeah, the museum did a whole thing on like protest jackets, you know, and I know Muse did like the disbursement, and, you know, you guys had some other things, but even in our social media, it's like, you know, I'm seeing this conversation now. It's like, oh wow, within my own circle, I prompted guys like, hey, use that art, tell me something about how did this make you feel represent, you know, how did this make you feel represented? It's like, cool, you write your name, awesome. Can you, like, tell me something about equality with those skills? You know, tell me something about freedom with those skills. Tell me something about, you know, what does the future mean for you with that ability? And, you know, turn our writers into poets, you know, turn our scribblers into painters, and really invest in how to to use our the talents given and desires given and the energy and even the reactions, like, hey, it's not that being reactive is bad, it's that it can't just be reactive, because you're gonna like go through adrenal stress and like hair fall out, and you know, look at all my white hair. It's like, you just can't be reactive. So it's like, how can we sow the seed into future artists and the future movers, so that when they're in a leadership position, they have a roadmap to start from, so that we're not starting from scratch.
And I go like to limit that reactionary space. It's like, to Shire's point, it's not a separatist movement. It's making sure that your community, is available. It has resources for those artists. Our communities right now, and the way in which we were integrated into society after 1964, they were destroyed. They were essentially destroyed, every Black neighborhood across America, And so right now it's finding out like where are those spaces that, where culture can be safe. We are a unique group of people in this, our story is very unique, and it's to be honored, as a part of American history. And when you come through a Black community, I want you to feel, the vibrance and the resources and the affluence. And that doesn't exist right now as is, but we can change that. And it will be less reactionary because people will have that support, and you can be in all spaces because everybody is free and everyone can come to these spaces as well.
I think we're running out of time. And so we have about a minute left, and I want to thank you all very much. Within this conversation, there was a lot of talk about organizations, things that people can do, community spaces that should exist, encouragement for youth, leadership, opportunities. And I think that for those out there, please reach out to us as individuals. Be a member of the community. Don't just be outside of the community looking in, but jump in and go to the bake-out. Go to Muse, come to the museum, engage with artists. It's very important for us to have a community where we're all sort of in this together to continue to push all of us forward. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Wow, what an insightful conversation. I want to thank you all for supporting us and showing up for the art movement here in Miami. We would like to thank Alan Kett and the entire panelists for bringing such an important conversation to life. Your remarks were vulnerable. They were honest, strong, and educational. I would like to urge all of you to follow the works of these artists and visit the Museum of Graffiti. And a special thank you to our closed captioning team. If you like what you heard today, please consider donating to the Miami Diaspora Fund. I would personally like to thank the Heritage Committee for creating a space for someone like me to make a difference in Miami's art scene. I am an African-American woman, artist, and customer service agent at the Adrian Arsht Center box office. So I would like to motivate everyone to reach for the opportunities that you desire. And if they don't exist, create them. Join us on January 13th for another episode of the Heritage Project, Black Greek Step and Marching Band Tradition. You can RSVP today at thearshcenter.org. Thank you again, and happy holidays, you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us. Shout out to Rosie Gordon Wallace in the comments. Yeah. We missed some questions there. Thank you.
Yes, Rosie.
Oh, yes. Yes. If we have any special questions, if you all want to try and answer them, let's see.
Yeah.
She says, shout out to Mr. Davis. That's right. I got to give a shout out to African Heritage Cultural Arts Center.
Yes.
It's changed a lot of lives in South Florida, so I'm very grateful for it. Shire South Miami Middle School. Save Creative Children. What do you want to communicate on to a national audience? That was Rosie.
I think we answered. Opportunities for help. I think we hit on a lot of, there's some new ones that just popped up, but I think we got it. I think, you know, one of the questions was, where can people get together in this COVID-19 world, and how to organize that? You know, I think that the idea of pop-ups are an interesting idea, but, you know, Miami, it's not so easy to create pop-up spaces. And so I think we have to look at the organizations that already exist, like Muse or other organizations, or like the Arsht Center, and approach them to help become collaborators, you know, work with people and organizations that are well-funded or that have spaces, and ask for the things that you want to see. Mm-hmm. You'll be surprised that people will say yes sometimes.
Facts.
Yeah. We got 13,000 square feet, indoor, outdoor. So it's safe for social distancing. You can come check us out, 2nd and 4th Sunday, December 27th. You have an open air market. So that artist who asked that question, if that, you know, if there's a collective that wants to happen or wants to see how this space can, you know, serve, we are definitely here. And thank you to the Arsht Center for doing this. You know, I'm a former Arsht employee, and, you know, I just really, I love, you know, I see what's happening here, and I really appreciate it. I really do.
Yes. Do it more.
Wonderful. Well, thank you all so much. And on that note, again, I want to thank everybody for joining us. And please join us again in January on the 13th. We are going to have another amazing conversation. Be safe, happy holidays, and good night.
We out.
War's over, the soldier on, still battling the ghost, no, no, no. Oh. Still struggling to see the signs, too heavy for a hard night, say.